Before I start the next session, I have another question. I have been asking questions since morning now. How many people want to start a business? Wow. Fantastic. I am not going to be funding any of them at this point in time. So there is going to be a fireside chat. Can you see the fire? Can you imagine the fire? Yes? The two speakers who are going to come on stage are going to be setting the stage on fire. That's why it's going to be called a fireside chat. And it is titled, Ideas Worth Pursuing, Best Sector to Startup In. So if you do not know which sectors to start up in, the two gentlemen coming on stage are going to be helping you with that. Do you think that session is going to be useful and are you going to enjoy that session? Oh, that was a very meek yes. I'm sure you all had lunch. Are you going to enjoy the session?
Yes.
Superb. So inviting on stage the first of the two charismatic speakers and gentlemen. You have heard him before this morning. He's none other than Ajeet Khurana. For your information, VC Circle rated him amongst the top 15 angel investors in 2013. He is a serial entrepreneur. He is a member of Mumbai Angels. He's an active member. He's called a deal champion. He's a screening committee member, an investor, and obviously a lecturer. I don't even need to mention. I don't know how many lectures he has given at so many institutes. Can we have a huge round of applause for Ajeet Khurana? And the other gentleman, I have known him for 10 years now. He refused to acknowledge or identify me today. But that's all about life. He's none other than Mr. Mahesh Murthy. Mahesh is a marketeer, investor, and traveler. He founded Pinstorm, a digital strategy firm that works with Cadbury, Nestle, Airtel, ICICI, Wipro, and others. And then he co-founded Seed Fund, perhaps India's best-known early-stage fund, with investees like Red Bus, Carvale, My Dentist, and 30 other firms. He's traveled to all the 7 continents and has visited over 65 countries. And you can follow him on Twitter, Quora, and Facebook. Ladies and gentlemen, these two people are definitely going to set the stage on fire. Gentlemen, the stage is all yours.
So, basically, my understanding of this event is that we are going to have a rather private conversation. All of you are going to eavesdrop, right? As in, so, Mahesh, they want us to kind of somehow do some magic over the next few minutes. At the end of that magic, everyone in this room
gets money.
Should have figured out.
Should get money.
No. Should get money by figuring out what sector they should start themselves. So we'll just end it in the next 1 minute. Do something in mobile, gamified marketing technology, social local search. Khatam sare words ho gaye.
Or also anything which is in B2C or B2B or B2 anything else. Or it may involve technology or it can also be non-technology.
Of course, you could go with a SaaS model, especially when you're targeting the B2B2C market.
So it could be a service or a product. I hope you're all very clear right now.
You could begin with a service which you can eventually productize, thereby taking care of your initial cash flow requirements.
At the same time, you can take a product and service-ize it.
Service-ize it. Suddenly the vocabulary went beyond me. Okay, sorry.
I'm in IIT, I can make up words here.
Okay, I'm going to try. I've tried to be serious in the past and sometimes I've succeeded, so I'm going to try again. Mahesh, you also try. We are at the end of a two-day session.
It's a Sunday afternoon. You guys really want to hear serious stuff?
You should be out having... How many of you are from outside Mumbai who have come to just attend this session? So many people are like, for them, it's not really Sunday. That
guys, you guys are from outside Bombay and you're wasting your Sunday at IIT. What did you think you'll find girls here? You'll find entertainment here. I mean, the movie hall's outside.
Yeah. When you said, will you find girls here, were you talking only to the girls?
No, I mean...
Iske previous session kya tha, malum hai?
Nahin. Excellent.
Okay, तो अभी हम लोग का कॉमेडी शो खत्म करते हैं.
So why don't you start? So essentially what we said, and this, you guys should, I think this is really a discussion where you should ask questions. So what, in the spirit of complete laziness, what we've said is we'll spend half the time with us talking and half the time you asking us questions or more. Half or more time you asking us questions and we trying our best not to answer them on stage.
Okay, so organizers, anybody raise your hand, tell me, we will respect your time. I can see a clock there. What time do you want this whole thing to end? And we'll stick to that. Somebody going to answer that question?
Or we may not stick to that.
The organizers have left the room. Basically, they are like, enough, we can't take these guys anymore. Okay, about 4:20.
What an apparent good time.
Yeah. That includes Q&A, as in all-inclusive 4:20. I mean, we can take 5 minutes extra. No, we'll finish 4:20. Okay, so we have 26 minutes. Okay, so I'm going to try to, like, you know, take the first shot at that. To be honest, I don't know about how skilled Mahesh is at this, though I've heard him many times, I'm a big fan, but you are not going to actually, at the end of any number of minutes, hear me say, pursue entrepreneurship in this sector. Okay, that is not going to happen. However, that does not mean I'll throw generalities at you. I'll give you some things to think about. Okay, so I'm going to start spinning 1 minute of soliloquy. Is that okay? So what happens is, when you read about entrepreneurship, you go to startup weekends, you attend sessions such as the one you're attending right now, one of the common problems that I have noticed amongst, you know, audience members is that they hear about a very, very microscopic type of businesses, typically the ones that get funded by the seed funds of the world, etc., or venture capitalists, and these are the kind that get covered in the press. So, the reason for that is because these are, to put it in a very decent way, sexy businesses. However, if you look at businesses in general, like you look at all the businesses you had to travel past to reach this room, 99% of that, or maybe even a number much proportion much greater than that, do not qualify as such. Likewise, you know, we threw some terminology, jargon, however nonsensical at the beginning, you know, the product, service, blah, blah, there are many words. Frankly, at the end of the day, a business has to have opportunity, it has to have market, it has to have customers. But you know, in a country like India, we just have so many things still left to be done that a lot of businesses have that. So for example, if somebody says, you know, the future is in product businesses, not in service, I agree, because those are scalable. But service businesses have significant benefits, right? Like they can get customers to pay in advance, they can get cash flow positive from moment one, etc. Likewise, you will hear of something called investable businesses, something else called lifestyle businesses. I don't know if you have come across these terms. And it is always said in a way as if lifestyle businesses are, you know, bad businesses or they are for the losers. I don't believe that either. I mean, again and again, I have found likewise. I don't think that businesses that VCs or other equity investors want to invest in are somehow intrinsically superior, right? So there are so many businesses which probably can be funded based on customer revenues or, you know, some amount of pocket money that you have, etc. So I'm just opening the thought with the fact that not just I believe is there no answer to what sector you should go in, but even the business model itself, I don't think there is any answer. Mahesh, some guru gyan.
No, Guru Gan. I mean, I think that's a really nice place to start on. There's nothing I disagree with that. What I'll do is actually talk a little more of about stuff that is here to open your eyes. I will come with a bias. See, when it comes to fundable businesses and lifestyle businesses, I must confess I run both. I help run a fund called Seed Fund, where all we focus is on finding fundable businesses. At the same time, I help run a business called Pinstomp. You can call it a lifestyle business, you know. We've pretty much taken no money. We've built it on our sweat into kind of India's largest digital firm. I don't want to sell it. I like what I'm doing there. So I run both. So both of them are fine. So let me, many of you are probably interested in, are VC IAT, what's this VC's point of view? I'm going to try to give you that and also then broaden it out. So I'm going to spend a few minutes with some interesting observations that should open up your mind. I kind of grew up in the world in the 80s, 90s and 2000s, all that, where, I mean, all the textbooks you've read, you'll hear that in a sector, if you take a traditional sector, take publishing, take pharmaceuticals, take automotives, ancillaries, anything, take television sets, computer hardware, you'll find that, say, let's say in automotives, the, you know, Toyota has a 21% market share, Volkswagen has a 20% market share, GM has an 18% market share, Ford has, you know, 16%, and that's how the market shares grow. Take pharma, again, it's the same thing, 20%, 18%, 16%, 14%, 12%. So all these sectors have pretty much the same. The biggest company will have 15 to 20, 25%. Next will have 2, 3% less, and so on and so forth. In these traditional businesses or businesses that we all grew up in, it makes sense to say, look, even if I start a company that becomes the number 15 company, it's still worthwhile. Because it's still fine and good enough. But so much has changed in the last 5 years. And I'll tell you what, it's crazy. If you look at a business like search, Google has 95% global market share. Microsoft has 3%. If you look at auctions, eBay is 85% plus and nobody else is within 1/10 of them. If you look at social networking, there's Facebook and there's nobody else. If you look at video, there's YouTube and there's nobody else. If you look at blogging, microblogging, there's Twitter and there's nobody else. Even coming into new generation business, if you look at electric cars, there's Tesla and there's nobody else. So essentially what's really happening is the business world is moving from one where everybody had a fair chance, 2018, 16, 14, to a world where the number one company has 85% market share. Number two has 8.5% market share. And number three has 0.85% market share, right? This is a winner-take-all world. It's a crazy world, right? So there's two things, good and bad, that come from this. One, if you're trying to be the number 10 company with no differentiation, forget it, you're going to die. Two, if you take an open sector, you have a real good chance of becoming a number one with 85% market share. You can become bigger than ever before, or you can become smaller than ever before. If earlier your amplitude of success and failure was smaller, now it's a much wider amplitude. That's a kind of first Ida that I wanted to put in your head. And we've seen that when we built Redbus, 85-90% market share, 10 times bigger than Make My Trip in the bus ticketing segment. Ditto with Carvalho, ditto with My Dentist. In 2 years, we're at 85 clinics, big, 10 times bigger than anybody else in India. So in each of these cases, you can build this up. The second corollary I just again want to put as a Ida in your head. We were all taught that, to build a big brand and build a big company, you have to spend a huge amount of money. But look at it. Have you ever seen a Redbus ad before? This year, we did 1 month of advertising. No. Have you ever seen a Facebook ad? Have you ever seen an ad for Google? Have you ever seen an ad for eBay? Have you ever seen an ad for Ferrari? Ever seen an ad for Red Bull? Ever seen an ad for Starbucks? No. The truth, and even in fashion, the world's largest fashion brand is Zara. $18 billion in sales. Have you ever seen an ad for Zara? No. Actually, the interesting thing is, all the new brands, and if I look at the Interbrand Top 100 brand list 2013 that came out, 44 of the new entrants in the last 5 years are people with negligible spend on advertising. It seems, really interestingly, that the less you need to spend on media advertising, the bigger you'll become. The less you need to spend on advertising, the bigger you'll become. And that's fantastic. That basically means that companies that spend less become bigger than companies that spend more. And why is that? The companies that spend less or have to spend less are the ones that have grown by word of mouth. And that word of mouth comes from building a delightful product that makes somebody so happy that everybody shares, talks about it. All of you have used Redbus, used Google, used Facebook, Twitter. How did you? You never saw an ad. Somebody told you. So the trick out here is, again, it's a double-edged sword. If you come in here and say, I need a lot of money, I have a lot of money, well, actually, somebody else with no money can beat you. Now, if you're sitting out here saying, I don't have any money, you can actually become a number one if you figure out how to create a product or service or whatever offering that can jump from word of mouth to word of mouth, because you're offering so much delight for the consumer, right? So it's, again, empowering. It's depressing in one way. It's extremely inspiring another way. So that's the second one I wanted to talk about. The third thing I wanted to talk about, and this is, again, interesting, is the traditional China philosophy. Now, China has huge walls around it, right? So the government doesn't allow any overseas company to really thrive. So Facebook couldn't grow in China, so China grew its own kind of, rent. eBay couldn't grow, so China grew its own Alibaba. So China, Google couldn't make it because of all these censorship restrictions. China grew its own Baidu. So I've seen many cases where people come in India and say, boss, I want to build the Google of India, I want to build the Facebook of India, I want to build the Amazon of India, I want to build the eBay of India, I want to build the Twitter of India. But the fact of the matter is, the Facebook of India is Facebook. The Google of India is Google. I also believe the Amazon of India will be Amazon. It will not be Flipkart. I believe the eBay of India is eBay. The Twitter of India is Twitter. So the fact is, you're linked with the world economy. Don't try to come here and do a copy-paste. Entire Indian business since 1960s consisted of copy-paste. Go get a license, do something copy-paste. Here, if you copy-paste, you will die, without a doubt, right? So essentially what you will see is that the successful businesses that get funded, again, I'm talking about that very narrow thing of successful businesses that get funded, are the ones that actually figure out a local problem to solve. And we'll talk more about that. I have, some ideas on, so I was just, my son's here, my kids are here somewhere, so the elder one and I are there. We were talking, okay, what are the kind of problems that we should solve out here? And a couple of ideas came up, and I'll share some with you. But essentially, your success will lie in finding a local problem that you can solve, that you can solve better than somebody else. It will not lie in copy-pasting. You can't read TechCrunch and come and say, I'm doing this version in India. You will fail. You can't read something in Wall Street Journal and say, I'm doing that in India. You will fail. All right? So that's my kind of broad theoretical framework. It's the opposite of everything we've been told, but it's something that we've learned in the last 5 years of investing ourselves. We've invested some 350 crores so far, but this is what we found. Our winners are the ones that need to spend less. Our winners are the ones that don't copy anybody. Our winners are the ones that take 85% dominant market share and build those brands with almost no money. I can tell you, I mean, Redbus, we took to 800 crores in revenues. We hadn't even put 8 crores in the company. Imagine that. It's a middle-class product selling bus tickets for 500 rupees to middle-class people. Bus tickets from Vijayawada to Hyderabad, from Doddaballapur to Chikmagalur. You can't get more middle-class. It's not elite, right? Those are the real opportunities out here. I'll just flip it over to you.
So, you know, this bit about copying Western models, I find that not just in the startup space, but in various other spaces. My mind goes back to the early 80s when my brother was trying to produce television serials. A lot of TV serials were, you know, the Hindi versions of a US serial. But eventually the ones that became prominent were like the Saas Bahu serial, etc., which is, you know, natively Indian. Because you have to try to solve a problem. But let me just, going back to the topic that we were discussing as to how do you identify what sector or what product or what business area you should be in, I continue to say that I'm not going to list that, but here's one interesting characteristic you should look at. I don't think that you should look at which ones of my businesses will I find investors for. You know, one of the problems I have had, I go to incubators and these incubators teach you to make better and better business plans. So I think that you should instead focus on which ones of the businesses will I get customers for. As in, that sounds like so commonsensical that you should think that I'm wasting your time. But I have worked with a lot of entrepreneurs and their entire energies are revolving around, you know, which is fundable as opposed to which is saleable, as in where can you sell them.
Yeah, actually, I want to add something to that. Think of all the heroes, the entrepreneur heroes who are your heroes. Whether it's Richard Branson, it may be Bill Gates, it may be Steve Jobs, it may be Jeff Bezos, it may be Dhirubhai Ambani, it may be Azim Premji. These are all people that you'd respect and love and admire. You know what's common to all of them as entrepreneurs? They never took venture capital. Not one of them. Not one of them.
Kal seed fund band hone wala hai.
No. I'll be very up. I've been saying this to everybody out there. We are only the second best way for a company to be successful. Overwhelmingly, the best way for a company to get successful is to get revenues from customers. We are the second best way. Even in India, so far, we have 9,900 some companies which are public. Only 3 have been funded by VCs. Out of almost 10,000 companies. Right? So I want to tell you that out there. Because you, I mean, maybe it just seems to be, chalo yaar, usne VC funding liya. You must understand that we are actually a very unnatural way to grow. And I'll tell you all the downsides of VCs. One, we are on a tight timeline. We have to return the money that we take in 8 years. So we only want to focus on high growth businesses, hence we tend to have a bias towards technology or brand. That's because, but the truth of the matter is, India, it takes much more than 8 years to grow a business. Even the 3 businesses that were successfully funded by VCs that everybody thinks are hot companies, you know, whether it's, you take MakeMyTrip, you take Naukri, and you take Just Dial. MakeMyTrip took 11 years to IPO. Naukri took 12 years to IPO. Just Dial took 16 years to IPO. Nothing gets done in 4 years. Nothing. It's going to take time. And if you're out there thinking, all right, I'll do this 2 years, I'll make my million, ain't going to happen. It's not going to happen. Redbus took 8 years. With a huge amount of acceleration from us. And frankly, if you had maybe much more time, if you didn't have to return a fund, we would have stayed in the state for another 5 years. But we just couldn't, because we had to return the money to our funders. So we will put you in artificial acceleration because we have to return our money. You may be better off having things grow naturally. Right?
So let me just bring up a new dimension or an additional dimension. A lot of times, so I go to colleges sometimes talking about entrepreneurship, and you know, I provoke some seeds of entrepreneurship. So here's something that happened just about a couple of months ago. Somebody came to me and said, you know, all these foreign companies like Tropicana, etc., who are selling juices in India, they have not understood the Indian consumer, who I have understood. So I said, in what way? He said, you know, sugarcane juice and nariyal pani are extremely popular as beverages, probably more than orange juice and apple juice and grape juice, certainly. So I'm going to, my question is, if I set up a business which, you know, Tetra packs sugarcane juice or nariyal pani, wouldn't that be an absolute hit if these people are selling like orange juice and, you know, mixed fruit juice, etc., etc.? Now, this is one of the problems. As in, by the way, I'm not saying that would be a bad idea. Maybe it will be a good idea. I have no way of predicting it. But What I'm trying to point out is that sometimes at the very early stage, when you guys are just thinking of ideas, as I know several of you are, or why should I just stereotype that? How many of you are thinking of what business idea you should pursue? Let's just look at you. Yeah. Okay, so I'm not telling you what to do. Because if you're still thinking, then it's a little less than, I don't know, it'll take a little too much time. But coming to you guys, often the novelty of the idea is such a paramount consideration in the minds. As in, I'm not saying stay away from novel ideas, but I'm saying that as the single-minded focus, that nobody is selling sugarcane juice. Hence, by definition, selling sugarcane juice is going to be a successful business is unrealistic. It shows that you do not know what causes entrepreneurs to succeed. And I believe there's only one thing that causes all entrepreneurs to succeed. Sweeping general statement, and that is execution. You know, going to work every day, working hard and making it happen, which is why 10,000 people start, you know, e-commerce companies, 5 or 6 succeed, etc. So now, you know, we're kind of getting to a point where we said we would start taking audience questions, but I'm going to say one more thing before that. You know, he gave a very interesting example that in the pharmaceutical companies, the top 6 companies or 5 companies put together might cumulatively have 50%, 20, 18, whatever, while a Google alone will have like 80 or whatever, some large number. Interestingly, so online businesses or digital businesses work differently, and I cannot disagree. But interestingly, we have not yet seen that level of polarization in the Indian market. For example, I think the top 1 or 2 or 3 e-commerce players put together, I don't think are at 99% as you might want to see in the US. Likewise, you know, there's no search player, but I find that India, hence probably, is a less mature market, which for you is an opportunity because that means there's still space going in. So any last minute guru mantra at them, and I must tell you, I say that in jest, because a lot of places when you meet people who have white hair, and I don't know who has more white hair, I think I do, but that's also probably because I have
I carefully dyed mine white.
Okay. So one of the things that a lot of audience members look for is, to use a Hindi or Urdu word, is a nuska, which closest translation in English would be formula. Give me a formula which if I consume or follow, I will be a successful entrepreneur. Believe me, even I would love to find that. Okay, so if any of you find that, please, these two chairs are empty, come and tell us. But I have not found it, but I found some good of golden principles, and I think that in the last 20 minutes, you heard a lot of those golden principles just like thrown at you at a velocity that you may not have captured. Right? I have to admit, this is like concentrated medicine, but I hope some, you know, thoughts, as in the Kida that he's talking about, some thoughts get stirred in your mind, and hopefully that will result in some positive outcome from the session.
So I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about a few things that, you know, I might be interested in looking at. If I had the time, I might do them myself, or if I might help back somebody else who's doing them. So one thought I always have is that, look, so we all talk about the growth of the internet in India. It's at about 200 million people. One of the issues I see kind of really coming us bang in the face is we have only 250 million people in India who are familiar with English. The entire internet in India runs in English. At what point does your maid and my driver and the paan ka dukaan wala start using the internet? The fact is that by making it happen in Hindi text isn't going to happen, because nobody is going to input stuff in text in Hindi. Nobody is going to input stuff in Devanagari or Tamil, you know, because nobody knows how to. Thanks to the far-sighted policies of our government, we have 8 standard keyboards in Hindi and 7 standard keyboards in Tamil. So, you know, we've really screwed up our life on that front. We've never known, none of us know. We can all use QWERTY because we've learned it, but we don't know how to type in Hindi, and I can't expect my driver to type in UU. So input isn't going to happen in text. So if somebody can figure out an operating system for mobile phones that works on voice and touch, I think that'll blow out and could open up another 200, 300 million people to start using the internet. Otherwise, ain't going to happen. We're going to just bump our head on the ceiling. That's one Kida thought for you. Another kind of odd kind of Kida thought for you guys is, just look at the problems around you. I mean, so if you think, real estate is a problem. Well, there's 5 years of locked properties. We can figure out how to open up and get people to sell properties. There's an opportunity out there because everybody is sitting on property. Somebody came up with something and I thought of something. He was talking about as a service and so on and so forth. I thought it might be interesting because everybody wants to have a nice society. So if there's 5,000 or 10,000 societies in Bombay, each with about 50 to 100 flats and so on and so forth, if somebody wants to do this thing called, let's call it culture as a service, as in every house pays 200 rupees a month, and what you do is, you're the guy who collects all those 200 rupees a month, and you send, you know, upcoming artists, singers to go and perform, you know, once or twice a month in a circle. So you can create a huge, large culture-based business. You know, even a simple calculation, you get, you know, 25,000 rupees from a society in a month, and that's 3 lakhs in a year, and you do 100 societies, that's 3 crores a year. I don't think even, you know, anybody's made 3 crores doing culture. That might be one, you know, just a random thought that came across. Just several other thoughts. This year, about 100 million people who are online are going to vote. Those 100 million people probably are in 80 million different families. So that means in their families, they can influence not just themselves, but their parents and other people who are not online. That means potentially 300 odd million people can be influenced online to vote out of 700 million people. That's almost 45%. The fact is there is not a property or a portal or whatever who can influence these 350 million people. You do that, you have 2 months, you can create India's largest, most potent political force, a force that can really bring the equivalent of Arab Spring back into India. Whatever made a Kejriwal work in Delhi can work, do it to anybody else anywhere around here. We don't really have a political vehicle to go with. These are just some thoughts I'm putting out there. On the way up, I was just chatting with my son, saying, you know, what if the auto rickshaws were electric? They're all short distance things. They only do about 100 kilometers a day. That's about the range of batteries. Can they simply do that without any pollution? Well, perhaps somebody can do that. Which brought another thought in my head. What if we had premium auto rickshaws where you didn't mind paying another 10 or 20 rupees or whatever else it is, but you could call them, they would come when you wanted, you had a bottle of water, you had better shock absorbers. I think none of you would have a problem paying 10 rupees more for an auto rickshaw ride. Hasn't been done yet. The thing about each of these, I mean, they may be good ideas, they may be bad ideas, who the hell knows, is that they could be things that, I mean, these are problems I've experienced, but you have to figure out the problem you've experienced. The interesting template in all of this is a lack of a template. They don't follow a Chinese template. They don't follow a US template. Many of us are taught in MBA schools, follow the template, follow this template. Exactly what I said, mujhe wo nuski de do. All we're saying out here is there is not a template. The ones who succeed are the ones who do not follow a template. And if there's that one thing that I want to leave you with, that the formula for succeeding in a startup is not to have one. Yeah? And I think with that, we can probably take questions.
I'll just respond to you rather than bring in new things. So see, Make My Trip allowed you to book airlines. I know they did hotel booking also. IRCTC allows you to do the Tatkal booking. I know they do regular booking also, but we largely go there for Tatkal. So here comes Mahesh Murthy and his team, and they say, why can't buses be booked the same way? Now, if you think about it in hindsight, it seems like the most obvious business. As in everything can be booked online or through technology, and buses were not being done. Of course, a foresight, forget hindsight, was that buses were an impossible problem to solve. What I'm saying is that I believe, even today, there are adequate number of these obvious problems remaining also. Which means technology coming and changing everything. As in, I'm saying that we have not reached that advanced stage where a bunch of enthusiastic engineers or otherwise entrepreneurs can't, you know, do some little thing and say, you know, this is happening everywhere, might as well happen here also. So let's say taxis. In foresight, imagining how taxis could be disrupted by technology was very tough to think. But in hindsight, all of these radio taxis or these Uber or this whatever, all Meru, etc., it seems like the most obvious thing to do. So I'm just saying that there are a lot of obvious problems that still need to be solved. Technology is often, not always, but then the culture problem, it may not be a technological problem to solve. But I think technology may often be a way to just totally change the way something is consumed.
Okay. Yeah, and in each of these, I mean, I knew the entire thing was what sectors should we look at. And I want to very clearly say the sector you should look at is a sector where nobody else exists. So by definition, the sector doesn't exist. And that's a sector where you can take 85% market share. So the only sector worth looking at is a sector you create. No other sector is worth looking at.
Yeah. So we'll take questions. I'll end by one saying which I...
Each of us wants to get the last word. No. You have it.
No. My favorite saying in life, it's in Hindi, so I hope that at least most of you understand Hindi. This is a poem that I had read when I was in 9th standard. I don't know if it's still taught. But it's these two lines, this couplet stayed with me. Okay, this is like more like motivating you to be entrepreneurs at all rather than what sector. And it goes as, you know what Gotakhor is? Gotakhor is a deep sea diver, because that's the only tough word in this entire thing. So it says, Main Gotakhor, mujhe gehre jana hoga, tum tat par baith, bhavar ki baatein kiya karo. Right? Thank you for the one bhava. Okay, so after Mahesh says what he has to say and have the last word, we'll have questions. So somebody is going to run with the mic?
Put your hand up. Okay, guys.
Or you can just shout out.
Give me a show of hands. Okay, ma'am, you're number one. You're number two. Shows of hands here. Sir, you're number three. Anybody here on this side? Okay, number four. Ma'am, we'll start with you, and then behind you, then number three and number four.
So firstly, I want to thank you for this session.
You can give us money. I accept checks, cash, credit card.
my question is that in the end you said that we can think ideas come from the kind of, you know, we think a lot and there are a lot of ideas that come to us, you know, as a budding entrepreneur or probably something who aspire to be an entrepreneur. But the only thing is that ideas come from, you know, ideas come wherein where we do not have our expertise. So maybe I might think of, you know, coming up with an electrical auto rickshaw, but I don't have the expertise. I'm not an automobile engineer. So the first thing that comes to my mind when I have a great idea that I think, you know, is great, is the expertise. And the next step is to get an expertise whom I can trust. So that's one of the...
So you can't execute it. You trust your idea, but you don't have execution capability. That's basically the point. Okay.
Yeah.
So I think two things. One is, if you look at the guys who founded companies, and all the companies you talked about, whether it's Twitter, Facebook was founded by a guy who did not know how to chat in social networks, right? Yeah. And so on and so forth. Many of us think, you know, that Google is the best website, but it was cleanest because it just had one search bar and nothing else. The fact is, it had only one search bar because neither Sergey Brin nor Larry Page knew HTML, so they didn't know how to build anything else. So just put one search bar, right? So if you think expertise is needed in leadership, technical expertise, the answer is no. Often the opposite. So it's people who have the business, who understand the market and the solution to the problem in the market, are the ones who run the company. Technical expertise can be bought, hired, married, whatever you want to do. All of that can happen.
Okay, second question.
No, I have one more question actually. Is
it in response to the final comment of his?
No.
Yeah, that is called shadi.com.
Yeah, you can stand up and say, hi, I'm Aries, I'm 25, I like to read and attract. No?
So just that, you know, you spoke about success in entrepreneurship.
Speak a little closer to the microphone.
And organizers, remember, if you don't take back the microphone, there are follow-on questions.
In entrepreneurship, for example, if somebody who aspires to be an entrepreneur, and if the person finds a space, but they know that there is a market, and but they do not have the technology with them, and they want to copy somebody else's, maybe not in India, but from abroad, there are a lot of technology that we don't have in India. So copying the technology from abroad, getting it in India, maybe the person would not know that what are the right resources. So in that case, would that be, I mean, how feasible would that be for...
So going back to the same thing again.
Can I answer this in two ways? One is to say that...
Mike Lillo.
Yeah. There go your marital prospects. With every minute, you are getting more potential grooms. Anyway. So the first thing is really to say that you've heard of people who cross the road and a vehicle runs them over and they die, right? You've heard of people going out and sometimes meteors fall on their head and die. You heard, no? Have you heard of people die of entrepreneurship? No. So my point is really that nobody dies of entrepreneurship. That entrepreneurship is not about, oh my God, what's the risk? But it's actually safer than crossing the road because you can't die from it. So I wanted to say that, saying that it's not so much a career choice as much as it's a life choice. Hey, main entrepreneurship karun ki main Infosys mein jaake I become the 1.5 millionth engineer, right? It's no such thing. It's a life choice. In entrepreneurship, I mean, I'll probably take a 1 minute segue. You know, we were all brought up to believe you put your head down, work very hard, and at the end of the rainbow, there's a pot of gold, right? I did some immense research and figured out that at the end of the road, at the end of the rainbow, we all die. There seems to be a reasonably 100% probability that you and I are going to die. At least as of right now. If you trust the statisticians, and you can't these days, right? And there also seems to be 100% probability that when you die, you don't take your money and go with you. I mean, Dhirubhai Ambani left 90,000 crores here to his nalayak sons. Everybody leaves the money. Sharad Pawar left to his nalayak daughter. All of this will happen, right? So when you die, you came broke and you're going to die broke. So you understand basically that there is no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Your pot of gold is a rainbow. All you have is a 50 years ahead of you, right? And entrepreneurship, to my knowledge, is the finest way to spend those 50 years of your life, right? You may succeed, you may fail, you may make money, you may not make money, but you will find that the guy who owns his pawn shop outside campus is far happier than some senior VP at some Wipro. You'll find that.
Okay, let's have your question.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, my name is Sri Harsha. I'm basically a B-School pursuing graduate. Sir,
so like there goes. Already, you know, I keep telling people that all the 400 richest people in the world, right? The top 8 are not even graduates and none of the 400 are MBAs. Their chances have already gone.
So, like, of course, that comes in my question. When I joined in MBA, like, I have this bug, entrepreneurship bug in my mind. So I thought something I want to study which is related to my pursuing entrepreneurship, like I want to be. So I started in marketing. So like my first question arises in my mind is like, just the way
only
you
one
said,
question, not first question. The pura question, kitna question? First question is only one question.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. When I started thinking like most of the billionaires are like, I don't even have a degree or a graduate. And when I started attending to these summits, like I get to know new words like scalability, sustainability, where there is an era of there is nothing, where the only thing is like original idea and then fire of enthusiasm to do something. And that is an era where there are billionaires like Henry Ford or else Steve Jobs. Now it is of course the 21st century where people are talking about scalability, sustainability, lots and lots of new things came
into
picture.
Sir, Sri Harsha.
What's your question? What is your question, sir?
You have no question. You are giving a speech. So why don't you just join us here?
No. My question is like, is it really important to know all these things or the idea and following passion is really important?
My God. Okay. Finally, the question comes. So, I don't know much. I did not even go to college. I'm a 12th class pass. Right. So, all I can answer is, look, everybody told me to read Kotler. I went and read it. And I thought it was bullshit. I tried to figure, why is it bullshit? I figured he wrote his book in 1959 based on research done between 1945 and 1955 on the US industry. Plus, he has never held a job in his life. He has never marketed a thing in his life. With all of these qualifications, how can I believe that man? So I made my answer, Kotler equals idiot. So forget it, right? So you must look for yourself and figure out who you trust. A lot of my own bias is if somebody has never practiced, then they don't deserve to preach. So look at the people who are writing and saying, has he done something, has he not done something? Look at us, have we done something, not done? Maybe don't done something, you say these are gas bags. So, right, your lecturers are probably gas bags and certainly most of the authors of your textbooks are gas bags. With that, I hope it enlightens and brightens your management education.
Okay. Now, you know the problem is without knowing it, at least without you knowing it, I don't know if Mahesh knew it, I am an engineer and an MBA and the author of 8 textbooks.
There you go.
Okay, so now, I'm having great trouble accepting what Mahesh just said. Okay, so what
he's going to beat me up later. And the word gas bag will be used.
So here's, I'll tell you how this went. Immediately after my engineering, this was way back in 91, I went to a business school, which is not how it is recommended. And immediately after business school, I became an entrepreneur. So I've never worked. I've been a faculty member at a university while I was a student. So according to me, if I look at only me, as opposed to a prescription to any one of you, had I not gone to business school, I don't know what engineering school, but had I not gone to business school, I would not have done as well as an entrepreneur. Now that is not what you hear a lot of entrepreneurs say. The reason for that is, that my entrepreneurship was characterized by I was always a solo founder, though I did multiple ventures. I was always non-funded except my last venture, which died a very gruesome death because it was funded. Okay.
So that's him getting back at me.
Yeah. Yeah. So what I'm trying to tell you is that in my case, you will never hear entrepreneurs really give value to an MBA degree. As I've never attended any one of them, and I'm the only one of that.
No, actually, I give a lot of value because all MBAs become good employees. They never become employers anyway. So yeah. My companies hire MBAs all the time.
So what I'm saying is in my case, I was an entrepreneur post MBA and I stuck to that.
But if you want to be an employer, don't do an MBA.
It worked for me. Okay, so now whether it worked for you, I personally think, okay, this is like my closing remark before like Mahesh just totally mows me down. I think pursuing higher education per se is a defensive posture.
Especially if they're nice girls in college.
So I went to business school in the US, so you know it was a little different. Yeah. So I think that, you know, it's a defensive posture to pursue an IIT degree. It's defensive to go to a business school, etc. Because your market value or your own perceived market value keeps increasing, opportunity cost, which prevents you from going in the entrepreneurial.
Let me talk about market value. Come on. Okay, you know, somebody explained to me, I was told the other day, boss, computer science at IIT, then marketing at IIM, best combination. I said, yeah, what do they become? They become bankers at Goldman Sachs. Explain to me, 4 years of computer science followed by 2 years of marketing to learn how to move Excel spreadsheets. And the absolute shining star, IIT plus IIM, is in jail in New York somewhere, Rajat Gupta. You should learn something there. Yeah, your question
there. Before that. Poini ma'am, who runs the incubator, is already showing me time out. She's saying you're 4 minutes beyond time limit.
Poini wants me off stage. I think we had two questions. Take those two questions. Yeah. It was his question.
We don't allow questions from people who wear suits in the audience.
His question and then her.
Hello. Hi, myself, Manmeet. I wanted to ask a question. You know, you said that there are 85% of the market share to come for companies like, you know, Google or, you know,
it's approximation, plus minus 50%.
Yes. It's changed, I believe, after all this. But you know, when these guys are these kind of ideas goes to people, and you know, for funding especially, you know, they say either it's a cultural fault that would happen in this country or it's a taboo as an idea in this country. Example, you know, if you give an idea about death, if you want to understand death, then you can have a business around death. People say, "Yeah, taboo, iska baat bhi mat karna, koi kharidega nahi tumse."
Why do you listen to what people say, yeah?
You should pursue a PhD in entrepreneurship. Nice analysis around entrepreneurship.
But my PhD topic is on death.
On death. No, if the one thing you learn is the first thing an entrepreneur figures out is never to listen to anybody. If you're listening to people, then already you're on the way to failure anyway.
Listen to him.
Not even me. And we'll take the last question, we'll finish it. The gentleman there. There, sir. He was there before you. He was there before you, yeah.
We'll give you private tuition after this session.
Okay, then that's fine.
Because Abhi, all these organizers are saying keep quiet. So we just
one question and
that. You know what? Shout it out. Mike will not reach you. There are too many people on the way. Just shout it out, we'll take it.
Start by, I am Virgo. I like.
Within 3 sentences, you have to reach a question. If not, somebody slap him, yeah.
Sir, the entire discussion actually was all about internet, e-commerce, and B2B, B2C, etc., etc.
Hey, boy, let him speak here.
So, but then, by suggesting that these are the sectors to pursue for, are we discouraging people to pursue careers in the, or maybe entrepreneurship thing in the core sectors like infrastructure, like, you know?
Okay, I just want to back up. I think the first thing all of us have said is if it's a sector, don't touch it. Right? That's the first thing. Unless you want to be an employee. You can be an employee there. The minute you see business world saying, boss, this is a great sector, and 3 guys are on top of it, that means it's too late for you to start a business, but you can join them. Right? So it is not about which core sector or whatever. Again, I just said we own a dental service company. So I don't know what, pulling teeth is not internet, e-commerce, whatever or whatever. It's just a regular company. We own hospitals, we own various odd companies. People use technology because technology helps companies grow faster if you can market online. If you can build brands online, the fastest way of building brand is online. That's all, right?
Sir, but what is the use of technology if it doesn't erase the poverty and eradicate the problems of the world? Like, you know, we spoke about Facebook.
You capitalist pig.
What is the use of technology if it doesn't...
wanted a political movement, right? You created it.
Yeah. As a response to your question, he and I are starting the Armed Technologist Party.
Actually, you know what? Your question is well taken. It's understood. There's no response really, right? As in, frankly, nobody told you to do anything on the internet. He said that in certain cases, businesses will scale faster, help VCs fund them, so they give quicker returns. However, 99.999% of the businesses have nothing to do with the internet. At the most, they use it for email purposes. Right? So, Shant Rao, you are with the 99.99 aam aadmis.
So, even people in the social sector earlier who are doing work to alleviate poverty, to get a date, they go on Facebook. So, for their personal lives, it really helps them. So, it makes them happier so they can go and then alleviate poverty elsewhere.
You can go on Facebook for a date or adult friend finder or whatever you choose.
Yeah. or walk around here and say that you are a Gemini and whatever. Thanks, guys. Thank you very much. Give me that.
Check. Ladies and gentlemen, once more, let's hear it for Mahesh, Murthy, and Ajeet Khurana.